In this episode, I want to talk a little bit about the Projection Man and give you an introduction to this tool. When you want to call it up, you go to Windows and then down here to Projection Man. And Projection Man stands for Projection Manager. Projection Manager is a tool that makes the work with camera projection pretty straightforward. It is not a tool to find the right camera position, and it is not a tool that helps you at all to create a working projection in terms of finding the original camera position. For finding the right camera position, we have, of course, this combination between camera and the camera calibrator. This helps you to establish a photo-based situation where this interface here and the calculation behind the scene helps you to re-engineer the camera position. This is not the theme here today. The Projection Man is the working horse during the pipeline, during everything that you need to set up. And we have here a very small interface. We can go to Photoshop or Body Paint as main mode. And of course, we can close that. In Edit, we can create coverage, and I will go to that. We can enable 3D paint or disable it. This is all a preparation for body paint if you like to go from there to body paint. And then you can open things in Photoshop or open it in body paint and so on. We will go through all of these and new camera projection. And there, I think, starts the confusion normally. It is, of course, a projection, but it is not based on a photo. It is based on the situation that you have created inside of Cinema 4D. So nothing is in the scene, and so it is not very helpful. Let's go to a scene that I have prepared for that. In this scene, we have created a camera animation, maybe from this point to this point. Everything is fine, everyone is happy, and then comes, of course, the first big message. The client wants to have some changes, and I have prepared this here to not waste too much time. So the camera should go in this way and then even to this point. Okay, so you think maybe that you can tweak this here a little bit to this point and everyone is happy. Okay, that works maybe nicely because your work so far was okay. And what you see here in the background is, of course, my sloppy preparation. I have used here just a displacer to get the stone into this camera projection as well. Don't bother with that one. That is just for the scene here, just for demonstration purposes. Okay, so the next step is, of course, the client calls again and said, you know what, the lens is way too long, my product is not really visible, I need a longer lens, and 135 is not fine, I like 85, pang. And then you have maybe so far already trouble with the scene that you have set up before. You might get away with a little bit movement to the left with the camera and fit here this hole in. But the truth is, in the moment you go to the start point where he wants to have it, then you have here a big hole because that was not the plan from the first point on. And I show you the whole scene here just in the edit camera. This was everything you have photographed and set up. Everything in the highest resolution possible. So there is not a lot of wiggle room inside, and you need urgently to expand this in two areas. So how to do that? And exactly there comes the Projection Man into the game, because you find now here exactly a spot that might be the best idea to work inside of Photoshop with it. And you see here I have a polygon there that works nicely now. And now is the big question, of course, what is the best perspective for that? Just straight on? That would be nice if we had only to deal with just that part here. But there's also the edge, and we want to have it nicely here, of course. So how to do that? For the Projection Man, we need now to have a view that is pretty much in the way we want to have that fix. And maybe this here would be a nice perspective for that. And we can go here a little bit out of that. The frame here is not really important. Important is that the whole thing is in the editor view. I have darkened here our frame because this here is set up to CinemaScope, very small, to make that clear, that point. And when we have done this, we go to this point here. And you see me struggle because my projection man is here in my special little menu that I have created here with my customization and with the customization stuff. You only have to drag things from there to there and you have your little guy there. Customization and then save a startup layout. So you have always everything in the way you need that immediately, because I use it often, one click and it's there. Okay, so to the interface. We have here a camera. This is the camera for the animation. So camera one is maybe not really the one that communicates for us in the best way, except you have that for each and every scene. Numbers only for animation, names only for projection cameras. That's up to you. So you have seen that updates here immediately. It's pretty much the object manager, but only for the parts that can create from the camera point of view and camera projection or that can receive textures. That's all what is inside. And then it is separated into major groups in unassigned objects, objects that have no camera projection on it. And of course, objects that are involved in camera projection, which I have here already. So the easiest way is, of course, now to go here and take a look what I want to have and do with my projection man, exactly the step that we need here now. So I go to the side, and just to go one time through and then I go through the menu, we can go now here to say I want to select this cube, and you see the cube is here selected. I can do this here as well. And this cube has already two materials here on it. Once is an alpha channel, and one time I have here just the standard material. There are two different textures in it. I wanted to show that we can mix textures inside, but they should have the same resolution. That's, from my point of view, how it works. But you can mix OpenXR and 32-bit Photoshop if you want to have multi-layered with the Photoshop. So the cube is now here twice selected, even with that one material. This material here is just an alpha channel to get rid of this. And you see nothing changes here. Command C brings me back. I didn't want to see this here. So I can put this away. Maybe it's easier to see now. What I need to do is to select one of these cubes. And then I can go to my edit and I say, I want to have a coverage rendering. And this brings me then to this interface. This is an automated process that creates a new texture for me where I can paint on. And I have to give this one a nice name. And that should be something, maybe cube and side patch. For example, something that you can recognize easily. And of course, I want to stay here in 32-bit because the whole scene should have all the qualities of super brights and the darks and so on. And I stay in RGB, of course. The width and the high is maybe a little bit overdone. I want to have 2K in both cases. That should be enough for this experiment here. And do I need an alpha channel? I can have one. I don't need one now. And selected objects only. Yes, that's nice. Start Photoshop if not on. That's always okay. And draw edges. These edges that I can see here are sometimes very helpful for the orientation, maybe even as perspective help. I leave this on here. Constant shaded or just normal shaded is something that you have to figure out because that's maybe a question of taste. It's very nicely described in the manual. And in the manual, you find this here in the help. This is the constant shading. It's just like a canvas. And it gives you the color of the object, of course. In when this is disabled, you get this version here. And here you can see everything with the edges. Sometimes very helpful when you want to have a guide or something like this here. Okay, back to the scene. So back to this interface here, and we can create even an animation here very nicely. And I would suggest highly we shouldn't do this when you want to have only an object. It is not needed when you want to have an animation inside of the scene, but the object itself is static, so to say, like this side of the cube here, where we have maybe no change over the time. If we have a projected tree that waves in the wind with sun and all of that, then we might take a look into this option here, of course. But keep in mind, alone 2K by 2K times 91 frames, that's a huge number. And just for maybe something I wouldn't see the whole time. And in our case, it would be maybe 0 to maybe 25 or so only. So be frugal with that. Okay, now I press OK and have a look what happens. The picture viewer opens. We can see here the interface, and with one click, everything goes into Photoshop. Is that always working? It works, of course, only when we have set up this in our preferences. Little hint here. And we have to go to the projection man, and there we have a Photoshop path. There we need to put our icon from Photoshop into it. If that is done, Photoshop opens automatically. And then we can work here inside of Photoshop with it. I go here to 100%. And now we can see I haven't had my alpha channel on here. So I have the whole information from the cube as help. We had no edges here inside of the cube. So we see only here a little bit from the beveling. I hope that is visible here, that grayish thingy, that's all edges. So sometimes that can be an overkill to have the edges on. Not in this case, of course. So now we have to fix this here. We need the side from that. Of course, I have created this here already, and this is another photo from the side. It's already in 32-bit. I merged it to HDRI, and now we can go here and grab this part. This is maybe all we need. Copy this and go to this image, paste this in. I have a different color space here inside, and this should be always the same. So now I have the fun to make that happen here. That is normally Command T in Photoshop, and then I go first very small, and I would go here normally with some copies into the game and go first with the whole page here with a little bit of seam, and then merge it over. We see already we have here a different color in it. That's not nice. We have to adjust this, and we should paste this here on the side, of course. I will do this because it takes some time behind the scenes, and I'll show you the result then. So, and I'm back after several minutes of doing something behind the scenes, and I have to admit I went back to this and I used this tool here, which I like a lot, Perspective Crop Tool. And I put here a little frame around this so I could get here a nicely rectangle already. And with that, I went then here to this image and distorted it with the transform tool with distort, and that's pretty much it. Oops, and I have to bring this back. Then I went here and created a mask for that, which went then right into the alpha channel. So I will delete this after all. And I have this image here then, and I wanted to have a color correction here. It's also very fast on the fly, just to show you that. It could have a little bit more light here and a little bit more color. It's not 100%, but I think you get the idea already. So I delete now here my layer mask because I don't need this. I don't want to apply this. I want to have all that flash here around. And I don't want to have this thing here inside while I move it into Photoshop and into Cinema 4D. I have to merge the layers, so I have this information backed in. And now I have exactly this. I can go ahead now and flatten everything down as well. So I have my alpha channel, I have this, and it's called cube side patch with command or control. I save this here now, which goes very quick, and then I go back to Cinema. So inside of Cinema, we can see that we have not so much change in the scene. We have created a material, a cover rendering, but nothing has really worked in the way we thought. So have a look. The coverage render editor or coverage renderer is just for the editor to get in coverage rendering, or the coverage render goes into the picture view, open it in Photoshop, and that's the whole idea here. When you go to the camera menu, that's a whole different animal. Then you can go here to new projection camera. It takes the current view or perspective and creates from here then just in coverage rendering. If you have a picture that fits already exactly to it or a texture that you want to apply, load the bitmap. If you have no idea and you want to start painting in body paint from there, new bitmap, so you can start from a scratch like the canvas. And you can use, of course, any option that you have already loaded into Cinema 4D. It's available on a fingertip. Okay, so I don't want to deal with this here at the moment because I want to keep exactly here this position. If I had moved something, my whole work in Photoshop would be gone. So I call up a new camera. This is now the view here. And as you have seen, we have the cube, even if it is outside of the render zone, because it takes the width and not the height. And when we had a square, it takes the height from this, and the width is exactly the number that we had. So we have to do now everything by hand. A new material, check off all the stuff that we don't want to have, go to luminance, go here, load that image in, and that was the side patch. Open it, and it's inside. Drag it to the alpha channel. Go here to this side and check on the alpha channel. Now it's there. The image alpha is set, and we see here from that preview we have the back and the front side. That will be fixed in a second. Then we have to drag this to the cube here. It should be on the most righted side. Has not really the projection that we want to have, so we click on that. We go to tag and to projection to camera mapping. Now it's the big chaos here because nothing has worked so far. And then camera one into this field here. And we can call this also patch one, maybe, to make that clear. So this looks not very well here as well. So we have to calculate this, and then it's exactly where we had painted it in Photoshop. And it needs some time to render. And now we can see here, it's perfectly there. Let's have a look what the animation camera has to tell about this little exploration here. And I think, except for the alpha channel, and we have talked about this, it looks not that bad. So we have here the first fix. You can also select the polygons and use those instead of the alpha channel when you want to cover an object completely one time around. That works nicely as well. Here the fast patch just around, and I think it works. Okay, so we wanted to see something else and a little bit more advanced. So let's find something else. I go out of my animation camera, and we could fix the floor, but I want to show you something completely different and how it works normally. So we choose now this point here because we want to paint on this edge here. We don't want to paint on our textures that we have because maybe they are changed later on and all this kind of stuff. Here we see a problem. Where comes this from? It's exactly here. We haven't set it up to front. It's gone now, so it doesn't project through it anymore. Now it renders even fine. So the idea was here to get maybe this edge and maybe this corner here. So I move this a little bit around, and I have not selected any camera. I have selected only the cube here. and I go to my projection man, or I go from the window here into my projection man. Either way, the cube is selected and I want to have a new projection camera and the coverage rendering. I let go of that, get the same interface. So there's no differentiation. Once you have selected it, you have to know what you do. This is now patch with cam. Just to make that point clear, I leave everything else in the same way and also here. But this time I go here, save alpha channel, and I leave this here alone for a moment. So I render this here. It renders in the picture viewer and I do nothing here. When it's done, it should open in Photoshop, and exactly this is done here. And you can see what we have done here. It's only the selected object, so I can't really fix the floor here. So we hop back to Cinema 4D. Do exactly the same as before. Click on a cube, new projection, and coverage rendering, and then select it only off, so we get everything that is in the scene. And this time, of course, I want to have the edges, so I get a nice idea of what's all about with that floor. Go here again. It should start the rendering. It overrides this normally, and here you can see all these edges and we get an idea where the floor is. So painting on something like that, it goes to Photoshop, of course. And before I start now here painting stones into it, I can do this, of course, here just for the fun, very fast, very quick. So I paint here a little bit in, and this is only for the demo here, of course. You might make that much nicer. So I put some stones here in, and just for fun, just something here in blue. And I paint here exactly something that should fit then, so I can see if that works here very nicely. This is all I want to do. We can use here, of course, layers, which is sometimes an advantage when I want to have different versions. Also, different layers can be selected in the material, and so we can project them differently. I save this here. I go back to Cinema 4D. I get rid here for a moment of the picture viewer. And then I can go here to my cube PD. That's not the one I want to have. This is here the cube with cam. You see, this is the image that we are after now. When I click on this, I can go here and reload bitmap. And I pull this menu out for a moment so you can see that. In the moment I click here, it is grayed out. If I click on the cube, it is grayed out. This is the texture I want to work with. This is the texture for the cube here on the end. And reload bitmap means it reloads it, and then I can see what happens here finally, because I want to have that in the way with my painting on. So let's take a look. Here is my picture, and I want to have the editor here. The alpha channel is fine, the luminance channel is here also fine. I go here just for a moment into open window. Image has loaded, the stone fragments here are there, and my cross is also here. So I switch everything off, I try to render, and voila, here we go. I miss only here the stones from this part, so I have to do this by hand because I haven't selected this plane here. But I can put this here on top, and of course I would have the need then for an alpha channel for this area. First of all, again, camera mapping, front, this is the camera with the right name, perfect, calculate, and then we have projected, of course, this cube here on the surface as well, but the stones are here. And the drill with the alpha channel, I think you got that already. Let's check this out in the animation camera. So here's the preview to save some time, and you can see it works nicely here with my painting on it. And I have switched off the stones because that had projected as well the cube back on the background, and I would have the need for an alpha channel. Okay, so that's done. Let's go to the next point, and I switch this here away. I have moved the scene here a little bit, and just to give you a preview, this would be here now, the place where I want to go. And I want to have now a texture here for the plane and for the cube. I have taken away the last result to not clutter here everything together. And for that, I call up again my projection man. And this time I switch here the cube on and command click on the plane. So now I want to have a new camera coverage rendering, and I have selected two things at once. So let's call that one here 2, so I know exactly what I'm doing. And selected objects only is off. That means that's only for the rendering. If I see only the selected ones, or if I see everything, and I press OK. And now I have to make a decision. And this is very important to understand, roughly said. It gives you here, of course, after I go back. When I press S, yes, then all objects get the same material. This is this area here. If I press the No button, then all objects will become a different material. Different material means a different material icon here. But the texture is the same. So whatever I do to the texture, it will appear in all of these materials. It has sometimes advantages when I want to make adjustments or different alpha channels, as we have seen here for the stones, to go with that logic further and further. So sometimes no is the best idea, sometimes yes is the best idea. You will figure that out, what is the best for your project. And when I say yes, it will create these two new materials here. And it's at the moment only one material in the object manager. And here we have in Photoshop, of course, the rendering. And when I go now here and paint blue over both here, then I will go and have the projection here, of course, for the background with the cube again. And I will have this blue stroke here just for the moment here. I save this, go back to Cinema 4D. Get rid of the picture viewer, and I go here to reload bitmap. Doesn't work, because now we have to go here to the texture that I have called 2. There's 2, and plane and cube is underneath. I go again, and here we can reload bitmap. And then I want to see what happens when I render this. Needs a second. And now this here is over that area. But keep in mind, in the moment I move it, everything will fall apart, because now I project on the whole picture here everything. That means the cube is again on the background, and the blue strike will be all over the place. So I move this here around. Nope, this has attack. So when I move this, you see this disaster here. The best idea would have been, of course, to go back to Photoshop, go here into my history, go to open, and call up here maybe just a new layer and create an alpha channel and do the same procedure that we have done before, and don't even bother to project this stuff again on it. So when you want to paint something on it, do it, and with an alpha channel then here you get exactly what you need. Okay, I think that wraps it up for this part. There's a lot of things that might help when you go here, maybe into these icons here. You can choose channels and all of these shortcuts. I think they are well explained in the help menu. I think a loud readout manual in tutorial form is not really the best idea, because it takes too much time. But where I can give you visuals, animated visuals, there I think we should have tutorials. Check out the help menu with all the shortcuts and double clicks and right mouse menus. It's huge, and it helps really to go into that. duplicate camera or unprotect camera, protect camera. Protect is here. Duplicate a camera is sometimes nice when you want to move something in the camera or change your field of view. And I think we went through this here completely. And back objects, of course, when you want to export this to another application. We have discussed this, of course, in the HDRI series. What is left to explain is, of course, here the channels, and they are in a different order because color and luminance are most likely the channels that we use the most. Color if you want to illuminate the whole scene, and luminance if the light is already backed into the texture. When I go here to my material editor, you find maybe the clues for these letters here. That is color for C, luminance for L, then alpha channel for the A, T is transparency, and then we have here for red the reflection, for R the reflection, the bump channel, then specular, and then that's not really clear. And when we click here, we can see what changes. The diffusion is on the most right-sided one, and the displacement is on the second most right-sided one. Very simple to get the secret out of that. I say thanks for listening. This was a longer one again, I know, but it's a whole tool, and it was developed for Sony Pictures, which is in use and has done or has supported tons of feature films. So it's a fantastic option to have that here in Cinema 4D since release 11. Okay, thanks for listening. See you in the next part.